release of gas. Our CPU speed is quite high as compared to memory. So that when memory sends the data to the CPU, CPU has to wait for some time to receive the data from the memory. Because memory speed is quite slow as compared to the CPU. So we have to take one mediator type of memory so that data from the memory has to be transmitted to the gas, that is the mediator. From this gas, it is to be transmitted to the CPU for processing. If we do like that, then the speed of the gas and the speed of the CPU is nearly equal. So that CPU will not wait till the data is to be transmitted from the memory. So that there is a gas, this gas receive the data from this memory and accordingly transmit it to the CPU for processing. Let CPU want to access some data from the memory. So what CPU do is, CPU first address the memory from where to fetch the data. Now the second step, from this memory, the data is read and accordingly transmitted to the CPU for processing. So first is CPU address. So now here CPU address. So now CPU generated one address from where to fetch the data from this memory. Now this address is transmitted to the memory. Let's say CPU want to address from 2000 memory location to execute. So now CPU generated the address of 2000. Now this 2000 address location activate this memory location, and once it is activated from that memory location, the next step, data is read from that and this data is transmitted to the CPU for processing. So this is the process if there is no gas. So what we do in this case is, now CPU generate the address and wait till the data from this memory location is read and accordingly transmitted to the CPU for processing. So that this memory can send the data only after reading, and to read the data there is a wait for memory function complete. Your CPU has to wait till the memory functions are complete. Memory function complete means it activates this memory location, read the data from this memory. After reading the data, this data has to be transmitted to the CPU for processing. So what you do is, now it first address that memory location, that 2000, by using one memory address register. So that when CPU generates the address, that address is stored in this memory address register. This memory address register activate this address location. Now once this address location is activated, next we read the data from that memory location. Now after reading the data, this data is to be transferred to the memory data register or memory buffer register. So there is a register. Now from this register, data is to be transmitted to the CPU for processing. So your CPU speed is quite high, but it waits till these functions are completed. So to minimize this operations, now where CPU generates the address, now this address is transmitted to the gas. That means CPU generated address cannot be transmitted directly to the memory. This address is now transmitted to the gas. So gas receives this address now. So the address, let's say 2000, that is generated by the CPU, is received by the gas. Now gas check. This is our memory. Now whether that 2000 address location data is available in this gas or not. If that 2000 address location data is available in this gas, then it does not require by the gas to take the data from that memory location again. That means data is available in the gas. So immediately from this gas, data is transmitted to the CPU for processing, so that it does not go through that step, which waits many times, waits for memory function complete. So that immediately data from the gas is transmitted to the CPU. Now CPU speed is nearly equal to the gas speed. So that immediately the data from this gas is available in the CPU, so CPU can immediately execute that. So it speed up the system. So that this gas is here. So the basic of this gas is, when CPU generate the address, now that address data must be available in the gas. If it is not available in the gas, then it is to be transmitted from the memory. So that gas is available. always contains the data that is required by the CPU for execution, so that the data is available in the cache and it can be immediately transmitted to the CPU for processing. If data is not available in the cache, then the CPU may wait till cache is received the data from this memory and accordingly store in the cache, and from this cache it will be transmitted to the CPU for processing. So if data is in the cache, then it is called as cache hit. If data is not in the cache, then it is called as cache miss. So the basic of the cache is, find the cache size. Find the size of this cache. This cache is very small. This cache is in form of N, but this memory is in form of D. So it contains MB of data only. Let's say this is of 1 MB. Let's say this is of 100 MB. So when CPU want to execute some data, if this data is within that is less than 1 MB, then all this data from this memory can be stored in the cache and it can be immediately available by the CPU for execution. But if the data is more than that, 1 MB, then phase by phase some of the data from this memory is transmitted to the cache, and from this cache it will be transmitted to the CPU for processing. So for that, how many data have been transmitted from this memory to the cache and from this cache to the CPU, that depends upon the size of the work. That how much data is required by the CPU to execute, this depends upon the size of the CPU. Size of the CPU. That means up to how much data CPU can execute at one time. Generally, this depends upon the word length. Word length. That means if CPU is of 8 bit, that means require like this, one word and one word contains 1 byte of data. That means CPU execute 1 byte of data at one time. So its word length is this. Now if it is of 16 bit CPU, then at one time 16 bits of CPU can execute 2 bytes of data. So its word length is exactly 16 bit. So like that. So whatever the data that required by the CPU to execute, so it takes the data depends upon the size of the CPU. Now think that our CPU is a 8 bit CPU. So that at one time it receives a byte of data, and this byte of data are actually available in the memory. That means this memory is also byte memory. That means one location contains byte of data. So that this byte of data again transmitted to the CPU, so that the byte of data that can be executed by the CPU is actually available here in form of bytes. So when memory transmits the data to this cache, now it depends upon the size of the cache. That if some data has been transmitted from this memory, the data that is transmitted from the memory to the cache is in form of block. It transmits block of data. Now this block of data is received by this cache. Now cache transmit word of data to the CPU. That means if we think that one block contains, let's say, 4 words. Now these 4 words of data is available in the cache, and from these 4 words, one by one are transmitted to the CPU for processing. So we can say a block of data is transmitted to the cache, from this cache one word by word data transmitted to the CPU for processing. So it depends upon the size. What is the size of the CPU? Next is cache line. How many lines are connected between this cache and this memory? Think that this memory contains data, and one block size is, let's say, 4 words. Word 0, word 1, word 2, word 3, like that. So, word 0, word 1, word 2, word 3, like that. So, word 0, word 1, word 2, word 3. So, it contains one block. Let's say this is block 0. Again, word 0, word 1, word 2, word 3, like that. Again, this is one block. That let's say this is block 1. So now, when data is transmitted from this memory to this cache. This cache. Now, at one time, this memory can transmit one block of data to this cache. So that, now let this block 0 it will be transmitted to the cache. And this cache, let's say, of this much of size, that is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Let's say this cache can contain 8 bytes of data. Now, when memory transmit one block of data, now, word 0 is to be transmitted to this location, word 1 to this, like that, word 2, word 3. So, word 0, word 1, word 2, word 3, like that. These words are available to the block. Yes. Now, again, when memory want to transmit the next block, let's say this block, now this block will be transmitted to this location. Now, if this memory is bigger and bigger. Now, let's say block W0, W1, W2, W3, like that, block 3. Let's say block 2. This is block 2. Now, when block 2 data has to be transmitted to this cache, then there is no free location of the cache. So, how to transmit this data to this memory? So, this depends upon the line of the cache. How many lines are there to transmit the data from this main memory to this? Yes. So this depends upon the type of assignment or the lines from this main memory to the yes. So for this, there are three techniques. One is called as, so this is actually called as mapping. So one is called as direct mapping, there is one associative mapping, there is one set associative mapping. So, if we have to take this mapping, direct mapping, then these lines are fixed. These lines are fixed. That means, word 0 is to be transmitted exactly word 0 to this cache, word 1 must be transmitted word 1 to this location of the cache, like that. So, next block, also word 0 is to be transmitted to this location. So, these are the direct functions, like that. So, like this, data are transmitted to this location and this memory is now full. That means it contains two blocks of data. So, block 1 and block 0. So, now here, block 2 is to be transmitted to this cache. Now, let's say cache is full. So, how to transmit the data? So, to transmit the data in this direct mapping, it uses one technique, that is I equal to J mod N. This indicates the location of the cache to where to transmit the data from this main memory. And this is the block of memory. From which block of the main memory want to transmit the data to this cache. And next it is the size of cache. What is the size of the cache? Now size of the cache is this. So, when to transmit, let's say, this word 0 to this, let's say, cache, then, where to transmit this? Now, main memory, word 0 want to transmit the cache. So, this is 0. So, now, mod, what is the size of the cache? Now, size of the cache is only 4. It, one block contains 4 number of data. So, 4. So, 4. So, this 0 mod 4 is 0. That means, this 0 word of the main memory is transmitted exactly to the 0 word location of the cache. Like that. So, to transmit the data, there is one fixed location and basing on this code, this W0 is to be transmitted to this like this. So, if we have to transmit this block to this cache, then again basing on this code, it says that this location is 4. So, accordingly, this memory locations are transmitted. So, when to transmit the word 0, now this word 0 will be transmitted to this location. Like that. This is the fixed location of the main namely lines with the gas line to transport the metal. And in associated gathering, there is no direct connection. Any wire can be transmitted to any location. This wire can be transmitted to this location, this may be transmitted to this location. So, in this case, it maintains to how to transmit the data from one memory location to this gas location. So, it is a time consuming process to keep track of how to transmit the data from this main memory to the gas. That means, always when one address is generated by the CPU, now we have less time to find out whether that address location data of the memory is available in the gas or not. So, it is a time consuming process. So, next is the associative mapping. From here, we take the advantages of direct mapping and associative mapping. That means, just like the direct mapping, there is one line. If some of the block has to be transmitted to the gas, again there is a line from that block to this. So, it indicates that if this block, actually this block, is assigned for the main memory block 2 and main memory block 0, then both of main memory block 2 and main memory block 0 is assigned to this location. So that if W0 is to be transmitted, then it checks whether this location contains data or not. No. If that is not, then this wire can be transmitted to this location. Again, if W2 wants to transmit the data to this location, then it again checks, yes, W0 is put and this location is available. So from W2 of block 2 can be transmitted to this location. So, you take the advantages of direct, yes, there is some direct connection. You take the advantages of associative. That means, from any location, you can transmit it to this gas location. But there is some fixed way from where it is to be transmitted to the gas to store the data. So, this set associative mapping is of many types, where we can say that two-way set associative. Like that, three-way set associative, like that. In two-way, two blocks are assigned to one block of the gas. In three-way, three memory blocks can be assigned to one gas block. So, we can say that there is different types of set associative. So, this is also type of mapping. Now, types of gas. How many gases are there in the system? The gas names are like this, L1, L2, L3, like that. So, this L1 gas is inside the CPU. That means, CPU contains registers. Within that, there is a gas. That gas is called as L1 gas. There is L2 gas, this is outside the CPU. This is outside the CPU. This L3 gas is also outside the CPU. So, how many gas are there? If there is one gas, then it is called as unified gas. If there is more than one gas, let's say there is two gas, then we can say that the gas are shared gas. Or dual gas, more than one gas are there. So the advantages of this is in case of single gas, there is one gas only. And in case of multiple gas, there may be two or three gas. So, in single gas, whatever the address that is generated by the CPU, this address location may contain instruction that may contain that. That means, if there is one memory and one address location is addressed by CPU, let's say 2000. So, whatever the, let's say there is one instruction MVI A15S. So, when CPU generates one address, this address may contain instruction, this may contain data. So, if there is one gas, Then this instruction, data are available in the cache. That means this cache contains both instruction and data as the cache is there. But if there is more than one cache, this instruction and data is divided into two parts, so that one cache contains instruction and one cache contains data. So when CPU address from this, now as this is one cache and this cache contains instruction and data, so there is one line from the CPU that is connected with this cache. So that when CPU generate the address, first always you know that when CPU generate the address, first address is always from the instruction. So it take out that data and after it execute, after executing it find out the meaning. After finding out the meaning, the data has been transmitted to the CPU for processing. But if it contains multiple caches, this is one cache and this cache is called as instruction cache. This is one cache, this cache is called as data cache. Now there is a CPU. Now when CPU generate the address, now this address is the first address, so this address is taken out by this instruction cache. Now it find out the meaning and according to it require data. So from this it can be directly transmitted to the CPU. Now if we have to execute this instruction in vector processing, then what is happening? That CPU generate the address for the instruction, instruction meaning is find out, after finding out the meaning the data will be transmitted to the CPU. So it waste time. But in this case, as these two lines are different, so that whatever the address generated by the CPU, now once you find out the meaning, immediately data will be transmitted from this data line to the CPU, so that CPU can be speed up. But the problem is the time taken to execution. Now, as this is single line and single cache, so what about the address generated by the CPU? It is always for the instruction, so that instruction meaning is find out and immediately take out the data. So that these address location are continuous in case of single cache. But in case of the multiple cache, now this MVI like that, all the outputs or instructions are available in one location. Now these data are available in another location. So once it is addressed, now it takes some time to find out where that data are. Because these data locations are different and it is available in one cache. These instruction locations are different and it is available in another place. But here the continuous address locations are there and data is to continue.